Good morning, Church of the Midcoast. We are so happy that you are joining us this morning. My name is Connor, and I mean that when I say that we are just overjoyed that you are joining us this morning for a number of reasons. First off, because church, we love you. We love you so much, and we just love the idea that no matter what, we're still able to gather together and to glorify God and to praise and worship Him. And then also because today is a special day, as you know. It is Easter Sunday, and it's a time of reflection for us to really be able to look back and reflect on how over 2,000 years ago, yesterday, the disciples would have been sitting in a place of uncertainty and of fear and of confusion after having just witnessed the Messiah, this man who claimed to be God, their friend, put to death on the cross. And they had no clue that in 3 days, God would move. He would not only just move, He would confirm the work of Jesus on the cross. He would confirm that it had not been a defeat, but it had been a victory. That through Christ's work on the cross, death had lost its sting. And that relationship had been restored, and that Jesus had risen. And so we celebrate. We celebrate and we're joyful and we come together and we praise God. And I want to encourage you to do the same today. All right. And as we worship, I just want to encourage you to just put aside all distractions. Silence those notifications. Get it all away from you because we have so much to worship God for. Also, I want to let you know that through a portion of the worship set that we're going to be going through today, we're actually going to be pausing and together as a church body, we're going to be taking communion. And so now's a really good time for you to go ahead and gather together what you're going to need to be able to take communion there at home as well, as we gather as the body of Christ and do so in remembrance of the work that He did on the cross and the fact that He has risen and gained victory over the grave. And also, I want to let you know that, again, this is a time of joy and of celebration as we reflect on what happened over 2,000 years ago. And I want to encourage you to share that. Share that with each other. And you can do that by snapping a picture from home during the worship service or during the service itself, during the sermon, and show us and share the perspective you have this Easter Sunday. Post it on Facebook. Go ahead and tag Church of the Midcoast, or even use the hashtag Flip the Script, which Kevin's going to be talking about later in the sermon. And so as the worship team comes up here and joins me on stage, I just want to encourage you, put everything aside. Worship this God who gave so much out of love for us to restore us in relationship to Him.
Covered in sin. Jesus was to be betrayed, he called his disciples together for one last meal. We read this account in the book of Corinthians. And as he called the disciples together, he took the bread and he blessed it. Father God, we thank you today for what this represents. We thank you that this bread just reminds us of the living bread, Father God, your Son who gave up his life for us. We thank you. And Jesus said, "This is my body, broken for thee. Take and eat." And in the same manner, Jesus then took the cup and blessed it. Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for your sacrifice, for being willing to die that hideous death that we deserved and you did not. We thank you so much for your saving grace through this. And the disciples took the cup and Jesus said, "This is my blood spilled for thee. Take and drink." And Jesus said, "As often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, do so in remembrance of me. Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin, your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. My orphan heart was given anew. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a
worship you, you're reminded, dear God, of what you have done for all mankind. We ask, dear God, that you bless the message that's coming through Kevin this morning to reach the hearts and minds and spirits of all who are out there today. We thank you, Father, for the opportunity to serve you in whatever capacity you have allowed us to serve. And we thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
My ruins, resurrected. God, this is the end.
You can't tell me you can make the dead in me come back to life.
Everything turns to ashes, but without the hope of revival.
Imagine living with faith in God. I can't. Get back on my feet, I stumble and fall, but I am too weak to make it on my own.
So my only option is surrender.
I throw my hands in the air. I give up. I ruin everything I touch.
It's foolish to think that God can restore my life.
Wait, God can restore my life.
It's foolish to think that I ruin everything I touch.
I give up. I throw my hands in the air. Surrender is my only option.
I'm too weak to make it on my own, so I stumble and fall, but get back on my feet with faith in God.
I can't imagine living without the hope of revival.
Everything turns to ashes, but you can make the dead in me come back to life.
You can't tell me this is the end. God resurrected my ruins.
Morning and happy Easter. Welcome home, Church of the Midcoast. I am so excited this morning, this Easter morning, to be joining you in your living room. That I get the opportunity to be with you as we have this pandemic going on and these challenges we're faced, but we are not going to let this stop us from worshiping together and celebrating one of the greatest events of all time. We are going to come together and we are going to celebrate today. If I haven't had the opportunity to meet you, my name is Kevin. I am one of the pastors here at Church of the Midcoast, and I'm so excited to be with you. Again, I want to say happy Easter on this slightly different Easter Sunday. One where I'm coming to you through the internet instead of us all being here in the room together worshiping. You'd be here with us decked out in your Easter best. So I'm just envisioning a room full of people decked out in their PJs maybe today, right? We're decked out in your PJs. You're probably sitting at home eating your Cheerios right now, still in your PJs on this slightly different Easter morning. I know there's a lot of things we were looking forward to about this Easter. We're looking forward to getting together, having our meals together with family. We're looking to get together to have egg hunts. We're looking forward to getting together and worshiping and singing loudly together. But that is not the plan for this Easter. This Easter isn't quite what you had planned. Truth be told, this isn't quite the Easter that we had planned as a church either. This isn't quite what we wanted to do as an Easter. This isn't how we wanted to spend Easter. We wanted to sing together. We wanted to worship together. We wanted to proclaim loudly what Jesus had done 2,000 years ago. We wanted to proclaim loudly this morning that the grave is empty. Jesus has risen. He has risen. He has risen indeed. So the truth is, Easter for all of us is going to be somewhat of an unexpected thing for us this Sunday. It's going to be somewhat unexpected. But what I want to remind you this morning is the first Easter was somewhat unexpected as well. And as we think about that together, as we focus on that together, I think we might find ourselves experiencing some unexpected joy today. So over the next few minutes, what I'd like for us to do together is look at a passage out of Luke chapter 24. And we're going to be looking at the first six verses. Now, for those of you who are joining us online, grab your Bibles that are sitting on the bookshelf, grab your phones and navigate in the YouVersion Bible app. Or if you're with us with our online platform, there's a Bible button there you can press on. Again, navigate to Luke chapter 24. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 6. And it says, on the first day of the week, Very early in the morning, the woman took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down to their face and put their faces on the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, he has risen." And that's why we celebrate. At the center of Christianity, it's not about some new moral code, it's not about some new perspective on life, but at the center of Christianity is the real story of 3 days: a Friday, a Saturday, and a Sunday. 3 days. A Friday, where all the sin and darkness of the earth did their absolute worst to our Savior Jesus. A Saturday of silence, a silence and waiting, a Saturday of nothing that leads to the third day. A Sunday with an empty tomb. A tomb that claims the defeat of sin and darkness forever. A tomb that literally changes everything, not only for the early church, but for you and I as well. And this 3-day pattern of deliverance and salvation is actually all throughout the Bible. In Genesis chapter 42, Joseph's brothers get put in prison and released on the third day. In Joshua 2, the Israelite spies were told by Rahab to hide from their enemies until they could be safe on the third day. When Abraham is afraid he's going to have to sacrifice his own son, Isaac, it's on the third day that he sees a substitute that God provides for him to save his son. And there are tons more examples as you go through the Bible of the third day. It's over and over. We see this pattern. It's over and over throughout the Bible. Day one, there's trouble. Day two is silence. Day three, God delivers. When Paul talks in 1 Corinthians 15 about Christ being raised on the third day, and according to the scriptures, this is the part where he's referencing God's pattern of bringing rescue on the third day. The problem, though, is day one and day two of a three-day story. When you're in day one and day two of a three-day story, you often don't know day three is coming. You don't know when it's going to happen because it hasn't happened yet. You get the pain and trouble of day one, that Friday. You get the silence and uncertainty of day two, the Saturday. But you don't have the deliverance of day three yet. So as we look at the passage in Luke 24, we look at these women. And they don't know day three is coming. You see, you and I, we have the privilege of knowing the end of the story already. We already know where the story's going. We know what's coming. But for these early disciples, they didn't know what was coming. And that's what I want to invite us to do this morning, is I want us to imagine that we were there. I want us to imagine that we were them. I want us to imagine that we were in their shoes, to consider what it would be like to be there, to be them on this historic day 2,000 years ago. So these disciples, they were taking spices to the tomb to anoint Jesus' body. And this was a ritual that was done for the dead. You see, they were going to the tomb with the expectation to find Jesus there still dead. They just wanted to do their part. They just wanted to be a part of caring and honoring the body. But they were still grieving. They were still mourning. All that had just taken place on that day before. That Friday before, they, you know, their hope had crashed and burned before their eyes as Jesus was crucified. The Jesus whom they had given everything to follow. The Jesus who they entrusted with their lives. The Jesus who they believed was the Messiah, the one true King of the world. But they just witnessed him being brutally executed before their lives, before their eyes. And then there's the Saturday. You know, there's so much written, and we've studied and talked about the Friday and the Sunday. And for good reason, because they were the two of the most important days in human history. You know, on Friday was our sins were paid for at the cross, and on Sunday, hope was brought to life. He has risen. But what happened on Saturday? What happened on that Saturday? Literally nothing. Nothing happened on Saturday. Even in verse 56 of Luke chapter 23, it says, "But by the time they were finished, the Sabbath had begun, so they rested as required by law." Nothing happened. Do you ever think about this Saturday? Do you ever think about what life must have been like? It's like that Friday night, the disciples had a restless night. You think about what they had just witnessed and what they had just gone through. They probably weren't getting much sleep for the past couple nights after the Last Supper and after watching Jesus. So they wake up filled with all kinds of emotions. They had emotions racing through their mind and their heart. There was despair, there was sorrow, there was fear, and there was anger over the injustice of it all. They wake up in this city that just the day before was screaming for Jesus' death, but is now absolutely silent. The crowds are gone. The fury is over, and Jesus is still dead. They thought Jesus was going to change the world. They thought they were going to change the world, but they didn't. Maybe they spent a little time talking about what went wrong, if you think about it. How unfair this whole thing went down. Maybe, just maybe, and I'm thinking that probably no one wanted to talk about it, but they were thinking that Jesus failed them. He failed. That he didn't come through when they thought he would. That he didn't do what they thought he was going to do. That he didn't gain enough followers, maybe, or that he didn't win over enough of the chief priests, or that he didn't overthrow Rome like they thought. Maybe he didn't get enough ordinary people to understand his message and stand behind him. Maybe, just maybe, he didn't even train his disciples to show bravery in these moments of crisis. Worst of all was he was executed in an embarrassing fashion, nailed to a cross. What kind of king would be killed in that way? Maybe they're, you know, when you think about these disciples, maybe they're feeling a sense of guilt. Maybe they're thinking, if we had just done this, or if we just hadn't done that. Maybe they were thinking, if we just could have stayed awake, isn't that what he wanted? He just wanted us to stay awake while he prayed. If we just could have stayed awake, maybe this would be different. Maybe this is a little bit of our fault. I can imagine Peter thinking, I denied him 3 times. I denied him. How could I do that? What have I done? Just think about the emotions that were coursing through the disciples at this time. Maybe they wake up and there's just simply confusion, uncertainty that they're feeling. They just don't know what's going on. They're thinking about, now what? What are we going to do now? Where are we going to go from here? What's next? We gave up everything to follow this Jesus, and everything from here on out is now going to be different. It's not going to be the same. Things won't be the way they were. What are we going to do? My guess is I don't have to try very hard for you to make the connection with that idea right now. I'm thinking in our present circumstances that we pushed and we've experienced a lot of these similar emotions. And these things are going through our mind in this very day, 2,000 years later. This Easter is a reminder that things are different for us, that life has changed, and we don't know what's coming. But yet it still leaves us longing for the things the way they were. Many of us find ourselves asking questions like, how long is this going to last? When will this be over? Will God come through? Will things ever get better? To be honest with you, I don't need a pandemic to feel this. Having a pandemic at hand certainly highlights some of these emotions. But for many of us, we are already experiencing them. We're already walking through the pain of the second day before COVID-19. We're already walking through that pain and confusion, grief and heartache, asking and wondering questions like, why is my life not turned out the way that I hoped it would? When will things get better? Will I always be this way? Will I ever not carry this weight that I'm carrying? Can anything save me from this mess that I've made for myself? Where is God in this pain? What is He doing? How long will this last? We ask ourselves those very questions. But like I said earlier, the problem is when we're in the middle of a 3-day story, you don't know when day 3 is coming. You don't know what day 3 brings. When you're in the middle of a 3-day story, you're wondering, where is God? You're wondering, what is going to happen? You're wondering, will this ever change? Or will this just be the new normal? And if we're not careful, when we're in the middle of a 3-day story, these events will become our whole story. People in the early church actually took this route. In 1 Corinthians 15:12, Paul writes, "Why are some of you saying there will be no resurrection of the dead?" In other words, there were some in the early Jesus movement that say, you know what? Death is the end. There is no hope. There is no life after this. Just get used to it. That's how it is. Don't be disappointed. That's where they had come to. And that is the route that some people take now. We think, this is all there is. This is the new norm. I'm just going to give up. I'm just going to quit. Or at best, maybe I'm just going to grin and bear it as this eats away at me slowly on the inside. And maybe for some of you, you're really close to that right now in this season. Many of us are like the women approaching the tomb carrying our spices because we expect to find dead. We expect to find death. But the good news for them and the good news for us is death is not what they found. Luke 24 reads, "They found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. So they went in, but they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. As they stood there puzzled, two men suddenly appeared to them, clothed in dazzling robes. The women were terrified and bowed with their faces to the ground. Then the men asked, 'Why are you looking among the dead for someone who is alive? He isn't here. He has risen.' They came to the tomb expecting to find death, but death isn't there. They came to the tomb expecting to find the darkest day are still dark. They came to the tomb expecting that even though the date on the calendar may have changed, they're still expecting that Saturday experience, a very, very, very long Saturday. But what do they find when they get there isn't a Saturday? But what they found is they get there, it's day three, it's Sunday. And Sunday changes everything. Because on Sunday, everything they came to the grave fearing and dreading, the things they expected to find there, the script had been flipped. Suddenly it was such a day of unexpected, you know, what they expected was Sunday to be unexpected, death-defying, grave-defeating, fear-destroying, joy-producing, life-giving hope is what they found there. That their world, like ours, had gotten over. The truth is, we are gathered to start this Sunday morning hovering around computers, which is totally strange. It's a different experience for a Sunday morning. We're hovered around computers, iPads, phones, TVs, 2,000 years later, because death did not win then. We're celebrating 2,000 years later because death did not win. What I want you to hear me say this morning is that as you sit here, the sun, the S-U-N, is rising to brighten our day. But so is the sun, S-O-N, coming to brighten our day. Paul writes in response to those denying the resurrection in 1 Corinthians 15:20, but in fact, he says, Christ has been raised from the dead. He is the first of a great harvest of all of those who have died. If you're unfamiliar with first fruits and first of the harvest, it's an agricultural concept. It's the first yield of whatever you're growing. So it's the first apple that you pick from that tree. It's the first cluster of grapes that you take from that vine. It's the first of many more to come. And Paul's saying that Christ's resurrection is the first of many, many, many more to come. You see, Christian hope is not simply that we're going to escape the world, that things are going to get progressively worse every day. No, it's merely that we believe somehow, some way, someday that things on its own aren't going to get better. No, we don't believe that. But God is going to do for the entire world, for the entire universe, what he has done for Jesus that Easter morning. He's going to do the same for us. You see, Easter story isn't just the fact that Sunday came for Jesus and his early disciples, but Sunday is coming for you and for me as well, and for the rest of creation. Easter is about the first fruits. It's about always a celebration, a snippet of a bigger celebration to come. It's a placeholder that points us toward what lies ahead. So yes, we're going to do this Easter. What we're doing this Easter is certainly unexpected. It's not quite the Easter we expected this morning. It's not what many of us wanted. We didn't want to be scattered in our homes. We don't want to be sitting in silence. We wanted to be together. But I think that's kind of the point. All these Easters, even the ones with loud music and egg hunts and big meals, are just the shadow of the Easter that is coming. It's just a shadow of what is yet to come. One in which Scripture says, every tear will be wiped away, and death itself will be no more. In our present circumstance, well, that's just a Saturday. our present circumstances, whatever they may be, wherever you may be right now, that's just a proverbial Saturday. You can be with God on Saturday in ways that you can't any other day of the week. Because on a Saturday, he's all you've got. Like the disciples on the Sabbath day, when they had to let go and let God. We need to let go and let God. Saturday is the day where you're at the end of your rope. You have no more. You've done all that you know what to do. You've put every ounce of energy, every ounce of precaution, and you still have to, and all you have to hope for is that God is going to step in and do something. That's all we can do. Let go and let God, and trust that he's going to step in and do something. And whatever you are experiencing this Saturday, whatever your experience might be, you can have hope. Unlike those who've gone before us, we know the greater Sunday that is yet to come. We know the greater Sunday that is coming, and the script will be flipped. That means all kinds of things for you. It means guilt will no longer have the last word in your life. So you've made mistakes. And you think, if we knew what you did, we wouldn't want you around. Maybe you've done some things you swore you'd never, ever, ever do, but you did them again. Maybe you've done that thing you promised God that you wouldn't fall back into. What this tells us is that Jesus has paid the debt for our sins on the cross. He has paid for those things. There's no more condemnation for you. You are in Christ. He signed and sealed the deal. His resurrection, the Sunday, is a reminder that the deal had been sealed. It had been done. You're forgiven completely. Guilt will not have its last word in your life because the tomb is empty. The script has been flipped, and Sunday is coming. Injustice will not have the last word. Yes, we live in a world that's unfair. We live in a world that unfair things happen. They even happen to God himself. But the resurrection shows that God is going to right every single wrong. He's going to restore 1,000 times more than we have lost. And he's going to redeem those bad things for joy. If God can take murder and turn it into salvation, if he can flip the script on murder, imagine what he can do with anything else. Imagine what he can do with what's going on in your life. Injustice won't have the last word. The tomb is empty, the script has been flipped, and Sunday is coming. Addiction just won't have the last word on us. We will not experience that guilt. The resurrection tells us that God has released a power onto earth that has overcome and defeated the power of sin and death. And it might not be a quick, easy process, but that power is there. You might struggle every single day of your life, but Sunday is a promise. Sunday is a promise of the ultimate healing that is coming, and that is coming for you. It can give you that motivation to get up out of bed tomorrow morning and keep fighting, keep pressing forward, because addiction won't have the last word. Anxiety won't hold us hostage. The tomb is empty, and that script has been flipped. And again, as a reminder, Sunday is coming. Sorrow, despair, anxiety, depression will not have the last word in your life. What the resurrection shows is that pain will never be the last word. Jesus will have the last word. Another way you could say is that as long as Jesus is alive, there's hope for you. Another way of saying it, if you're not dead, God's not done. If you're not dead, God's not done. And a quote from Billy Graham once said, "Someday you will read or hear that Billy Graham is dead. Don't believe a word of it. I shall be more alive than I am now. I will have changed my address. I will have gone into the presence of God." This is true for each and every one of us who are in Christ. Because the script has been flipped. The tomb is empty, and Sunday is coming, and it's coming for you too. And all that other stuff, all those other struggles, all those other things, that's just Saturday. That's just Saturday. So I want you to do something for me after we close today's service in a song of praise led by our worship team. I want you to walk outside, and I want you to look up at the sun, the same sun that rose 2,000 years ago when these disciples were coming to the tomb. I want you to praise and thank God that the sun is rising on this Sunday as well. Sunday changes everything. Sunday flips the script. For the sun has risen, he has risen indeed. Let us pray. Father God, we are just so thankful for the sacrifice of your son and the opportunity we have to celebrate today that the grave is empty. He has risen. He has flipped the script. God, you've made so much available to us that we just need to turn to you, need to turn to your son, Jesus, and allow him into our lives. He brings us so much hope. He brings us life. He brings us joy and peace in those Saturdays. In those Saturdays experience, we recognize that Sunday is still coming. Sunday will be here. Each of us have available that Sunday experience because you sacrificed your son, because he died on a cross for us, because on the third day he was risen from the dead, the tomb was empty. And we thank you for that. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to share this message. I thank you for the opportunity to do it in an unusual platform, that as people are hovered around their devices this morning and their TVs and their computers around living rooms and dining rooms, and this Easter Sunday isn't the traditional celebration that we had planned. But look, let us see that you are in it, God. Let us see that you are a part of it wherever we are at. Let us see the hope that you have brought. That we don't have to just be in a four walls of a church building. That you are available to us wherever we are at. You just ask us to turn to you, to accept you. Lord, I just thank you that on this Easter, the sun has risen. It is a joyous day. Sunday is coming. And God, I just thank you for flipping the script on each and every one of us. God, we thank you for the love you show us. We thank you for the Easter celebrations that are going to be taking part all around this region, all around the globe today. God, we recognize that your ways are higher than ours, and you can work through internet signals, and you can work through broadcasts, and you are working in amazing ways. So let us recognize that you are in this. You are in whatever that Saturday experience we are having right now. You are present. Sunday is coming. We pray this in your son Jesus' precious name. And everyone says, amen, amen, amen. Well, if you're new to Church of the Midcoast, one of the things that we do each and every week is we are committed to getting into God's word on a daily basis. And we do that through sharing a devotion as a church, and we read a devotion together. So this week's devotion is up over here. It's facing the unknown, facing the unknown. And I think the host will probably put that in the comments of the platform so you can join us, or I will be sending out an invite later on, or you can see the invite on our social media platforms. And we would love for you to join us as we read God's word this week in this devotion, Facing the Unknown. If you don't have the YouVersion Bible app, I encourage you to get it at this time. It's a great opportunity to be carrying God's word around right in your back pocket and being able to refer to it whenever you feel the opportunity. Now is the time that we have the opportunity to worship with our finances. And as we prepare to wrap up our Easter service, and we're going to close with a great worship song that is a reminder that God is faithful, that he will do it again. We also have the opportunity to worship our finances and the increase that God has provided for us. When we think about tithe and giving, we should think about it as a form of worship, not as a form of funding. It's easy to express our faith to God in various ways, but one of the ways we can do it in these times that are unprecedented, if we're putting that much faith into God to believe that he will meet our needs. During this season of uncertainty and global epidemic, it can cause a lot of concern for us about where the next dollar is coming from, where the next meal is coming from. But it's even more opportunity for us to put our trust in what he is doing and how he provides for us, how he provides on the third day for that Sunday experience. So don't allow the Friday and Saturday to diminish your faith in what's coming on Sunday. We trust that God is working, and as we worship, we're able to worship not only in song, not only listening to God's word, but we're able to worship with our finances. And since we're meeting online, we made a couple of easy options for you to worship with your finances online. The easiest option is the text to give option. We can text your dollar amount to 84321. And there'll be some prompts to follow you through to make it easy for you. Also, the host will be putting up our online giving options if you want to worship with your finances that way. So let us pray. Father God, I just thank you for today. I just thank you for the opportunity to share this message with you. I just thank you for what you are doing through Church of the Midcoast and the ability that we have to provide and meet needs in this community, Lord. I just ask for you to multiply, to guide us in the use of these resources, to meet the needs in this crazy time that we're in right now. Father God, just thank you for all that you're doing. We just ask you to bless and multiply these tithes and offerings and where they have come from. And we just pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
No.
Happy Easter.